Praise God for this wonderful day, Sunday po, and second Sunday of the month. And we are praising God for the chance that we can come again and worship Him together as one at makapag-lift up the name ng Panginoon. Today's message is about the danger of drifting, which I think we have in our D group. At nagpapasalamat ako sa Panginoon for the realization and the things discovered through the help of the Holy Spirit na galing sa salita ng Panginoon, which really, really are very important nowadays, especially as we journey every day in our life of faith. The danger of drifting is found in Hebrews chapter 1, 1 up to 4. Yan po ang text natin today. Let's commit this word of God to Him. And mag-pray po tayo at magingi ng tulong sa Panginoon, especially the Holy Spirit, to understand His word for us today. Okay, shall we pray? Our gracious, almighty, heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for today, for the chance again to worship you in spirit and in truth. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before thy presence. We know that we engage the presence of a holy God, and we ask forgiveness of our sins. Even as we linger in our presence, may our presence before thee will be worthy as we stand, and even as we talk about your word and ponder upon it, as the Holy Spirit will fill our hearts in this place, may he will also illumine our minds to understand. Praying also, Lord, for those who are worshiping together with us online. Apo, mag-bless sa kanila and empower them, the Holy Spirit, to understand your word so that they will put your word in their hearts and be enabled by the Holy Spirit to live it out. Be with us, Lord, as we ponder upon your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Since this is found in Hebrews chapter 2, sa kakastart lang ng chapter ng book na ito, I would like to give you a little background. Kasi ang Bible dire-diretso eh. Hindi siya nagbibigay ng background. It's up to those who study the Word of God to find the background and the context of the Word of God so that we can understand thoroughly. So, pinapakita lang sa atin kung maintindihan natin ang background at saka context na hindi pala masyadong magkalayo ang kinaibahan ng time during the book was written and sa ating panahon ngayon. So, it's very, very important din. Okay, ang letter ng, or ang author ng Hebrews, marami silang suspetso kung sino nagsulat. Kasi ang way of writing is like the Apostle Paul or what. Pero still, hindi siya specific na talaga si Apostle Paul ang nagsulat. So let's, kung ang Bible ay anonymous, ang pagsulat niyan din, okay. Let's consider it as anonymous. Pero ang isang sigurado dito na makita natin, ang letter na ito, because this is a letter, this letter is intended to the Jewish Christians. So, sinulat ito para sa mga Jewish Christians na nabilong sa kanilang community. Pero as Christians, they were minority. Hindi sila ang majority na nagko-compose ng population. Okay. It is a letter also that addresses the experiences, the challenges nitong mga Christians during their time. So, isa sa mga challenges nila na nakita ng author na nagsulat nito is that they have a tendency to abandon their faith. Parang i-set aside na nila ang faith nila na natanggap galing sa mga apostles and disciples before. So, dangerous pala ang time during this letter was written. Okay? So, they were challenged to go back to their original religion. Alam natin ng Israel, ang major religion nila since is Judaism. So parang they believe in the Old Testament. Now they don't really consider the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord. So Judaism, So yung mga Christians minority, they were tempted to go back to that religion. Isa pa, hindi lang may mga religious group, may mga philosophy din during the time. Itong mga Stoicism, Epicureanism, at saka itong mga mystery cults. So kung i-combine mo, mga apat ang na-mention. But I believe there are still many. Apat ang nagbubombard sa kanila to go back to their original faith. So araw-araw yan, sa trabaho, sa mga neighbor, sa kanilang paligid, siguro sa mga ano nila, kasi itong mga Christians na ito ay they were not privileged to have the privilege of Jewish people. Siguro may mga persecution din. Okay. And I'm sure that they have. Ang mabilhan nila, ang mga lugar na hindi nila mapuntahan, they were Jews, but they were persecuted din sa lahat ng mga aspect. What else? During this time, ang Roman Empire ang may power sa lugar. Hanggang Asia Minor to eh, di ba, ang Roman Empire. Hindi lang sa Israel, Asia Minor, which is Turkey ngayon. Nasakop pa yan ng Roman Empire. So, ang idea ng letter ng Hebrews, if you're going to look at the background, is this. Ang mga Christians has a tendency to drift from their faith. Of which, this is the first topic that we have. My dangers of drifting from their faith to go back to their original religion. So this is the purpose of the author to write to them, to encourage them to continue doing or living out their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. If we are going to consider the book of Hebrews, which is a letter para sa kanila, what those Christians were facing is we also have the same challenge today. Hindi magkalayo ang pinagkaibahan nila sa atin ngayon. The challenge of drifting away from our steadfast faith in the Lord was also a challenge for them during their time. Now, alam nyo, nag-start tayo sa chapter 2. But if you are going to start reading verse 1, verse 1 starts with therefore. It starts with therefore, the idea of therefore. That means he's talking about chapter 1. So we will miss the point kung mag-start ka sa chapter 2 if we are not going to consider the truth found in chapter 1. Now, let me give you this idea sa chapter 1 kasi papasok agad tayo sa chapter 2. Ano ba ang emphasis ng author sa chapter 1? Ang emphasis ng author sa chapter 1, ang supremacy ni Jesus Christ. Okay? Jesus Christ is supreme. He is superior to all other messengers and revelation that God has sent in the past, including sa Old Testament. Yan ang emphasis ng author. The author also said that Jesus is the heir of all things and the radiance of God's glory. Ibig sabihin yan, sabi ng author, si Jesus, pag nakita mo ang Panginoon. E diba, one time, Thomas asked Jesus, Lord, when can we see the Father? Anong sabi ni Jesus? You who had seen me had seen the Father. So he is the radiance of God's glory. Yan ang sinasabi ng author. What else? Si Jesus is the divine and eternal Son who surpasses all created beings. What else? Jesus is also compared to angels. But Jesus is superior to angels. At ang author nagbigay ng mga passages galing sa Bible din to support his claim that Jesus is superior to angels. Now, the book of Hebrews is not only a message. Kung tingnan natin, it is a warning. It is a warning to the Jewish Christians and also to us. Now, I want us to notice na ito palang book of Hebrews, as I study, there are 6 danger signals na binibigay ng author para sa lahat na makabasa ng letter na ito. Okay? A warning that was given to the Jews, but if you're going to look at it in the implication of the book, it's also 6 danger signals given to us. So when I realized this, sabi ko, ala, ang ganda pala nitong i-series ang Book of Hebrews. Number 1, which is found here sa ating title, The Danger of Drifting, chapter 2, 1 up to 4. Next warning, number 2, the danger of doubting. Okay? Number 3, the danger of dull hearing. Number 4, the danger of departing. Number 5, the danger of despising. And also the last one, the danger of denying. So if you look at the background of the letter, makita mo that author is really, really concerned for the Christians during their time. Yun nga, may mga challenges sila that some of them maybe returned to the original Judaism religion. But some of them almost, siguro yung iba sa kanila nagpasalamat na meron letter sila na natanggap. Okay? So let's go to our text. Hebrews 2, 1 up to 4. Sabi ng author, "For this reason, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard so that we do not drift away from it. For if the word spoken through angels prove unalterable, and every violation and act of disobedience receive a just punishment, how will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? After it was first spoken through the Lord, it was confirmed to us by those who heard, God also testifying with them, both by signs and wonders, and by various miracles, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to His own will." Now, itong tugon ng author. Actually, nakakonsentrate ang title natin dito sa verse 1. "For this reason, therefore," yan po ang ibig sabihin, "we must pay closer attention to what we have heard so we do not drift away from it." Now, the question I have is, what was the instruction given to the Christian believers? Ano ang instruction na binigay sa kanila? Diba? According to the word, ang instruction is, pay much closer attention. Anong ibig sabihin nito? It means to apply oneself to. So, kung gamitin natin ang word to apply oneself to, it means we apply oneself to the things we have heard. The other word is adhere. Right? Now, anong ibig sabihin ng to apply oneself to? Ito pala ang apply oneself to, ito ay isang idiomatic expression that means to devote time, to devote effort, to devote attention, to devote focus to the things we have heard before. So hindi mo lang basahin. Hindi mo lang siya pag-isipan. You're going to devote time. You're going to devote focus. You're going to devote attention to those things which they have heard before. Isa-isahin natin ito. Because when we look at the Word of God deeper, we will understand what the author is trying to say. Now, we will be helped by the original word na binibigay sa atin. So, anong ibig sabihin nito? It implies... Hello? Mike. Okay na. Thank you. Okay. Now, To apply oneself to implies a deliberate and concentrated effort to engage in or work on something. So the author was trying to say to the believers, put more focus, put more attention to the things which you have heard before so that you will avoid drifting in your spiritual life. Now, my next question, to what particular thing are they going to devote their time to, their effort, their attention? To what we have heard? Ito ang sinasabi ng author. What you have heard, put more focus on it. Meditate on it. Think about it. To what they have heard. Now, ano itong to what they have heard? Now, sabi natin kanina, we are going to miss the point of verses 1 up to 4 ng chapter 2 kung hindi natin isipin ang chapter 1. Ang ibig sabihin pala ng author dito, the things that they have heard is the revelation of God through Jesus Christ. So the author was saying, in a simple idea, pay much close attention to the things about the revelation of God through Jesus Christ. Now, my next question, why did the author put emphasis on the revelation of Christ? They were struggling in their faith. Some of them were drifting. Bakit binagyan ng author emphasis ang revelation ng Diyos sa kay Jesus Christ? Alam niyong sagot is this, because God is manifested in Jesus Christ. God's word before, God's message, God's covenant, God's oath to His people are in Jesus Christ, whom He has given all authority all throughout. Listen to what the author has said. Ito ha, sa chapter 1, verse 1. Tingnan niyo kung bakit nabigyan niya ng emphasis si Jesus Christ sa chapter 2. Itong sabi niya, God, after He spoke long ago to the fathers in the prophets, Old Testament, in many portions and in many ways, itong sinasabi niya, in these last days, parang ibig sabihin, in these last days, God has spoken to us in His Son. So ang ibig sabihin niyan, the words of the Lord Jesus Christ are the words of God spoken by the Lord Jesus Christ. Meaning, God is speaking to us now through the Lord Jesus Christ. If God the Father has spoken to the people in the Old Testament, Jesus Christ is speaking to us now, whom He appointed heir of all things, through whom also He made the world. The Old Testament was saying, the revelation about Jesus Christ is superior to the Old Testament system of principles, rules ordained and administered, and so forth. So, ang idea ng author, if Jesus Christ has spoken, we must listen to Him. So, ang tinitingnan ko ba na when the author was speaking to the Christian believers during their time, sabi niya, give or pay much attention or close attention to what the Lord Jesus Christ is saying so that you will not drift from your faith. In other words, our responsibility who belongs in these last days, tayo yan, is greater compared to the people in the past. Meaning, we have now the responsibility of putting more emphasis in obeying and fulfilling the words, the commands, and promises of Jesus Christ. Kaya nga ang bagay na ginagawa natin dito in this particular body of Christ, ang ginagawa natin, let's make sure that we are certain about the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. His purpose for us, kung ano ang mga plano niya sa atin, at ano ang ibig sabihin niya sa kanyang salita. So that we will be certain and sure in our walk with Him. Kasi hindi ibig sabihin, binabasa palagi ang Bible, automatically, maintindihan agad. You know, kung tingnan natin, ano ba ang rason kung bakit maraming religious group? You consider asking bakit ano ang rason? Isa sa mga major reason is that maraming iba't ibang interpretation. Right? They interpret. Sige, with respect to other religious groups, of course. Iba-iba. Okay? Iba-iba. Yan po ang rason. Let's be certain that we know both which are God's promises and commands for us. Ito po ang bagay na I would like to give focus or just to mention. May mga bagay ang Panginoon na binigay sa kanyang salita which are commands. And there are also words which are promises. Magkaiba ang dalawa. So, kung tingnan natin, dapat maging certain tayo kung ano ang mga promise ng Panginoon at saka commands ng Panginoon. It greatly affects our walk. Now, ang ibig sabihin dito, obey it before He comes again. Kung merong sinabi si Jesus Christ, give more emphasis on it. Obey it before He comes again. For we are sure that when Jesus gave His commands and promises, He's going to require an answer for it. Pag nagbigay siya ng command, He's going to require an answer sa kanyang command. Kung meron pang mga bagay na hindi niya makalimutan, I know that God does not forget. No? Wala, hindi. Yung mga bagay na nakumand niya sa atin. So as a church, as a body of Christ, let's make sure that first, we know what are His commands, and then ikalawa, to follow what He commands. Alam nyo, sometimes, we Christians make the mistake of thinking that everything God says in His Word is a promise. Hindi. Do not think that everything God says in the Bible is a promise. Okay? Kasi marami ngayon nagko-quote ng verse na, say, na promise ng Panginoon, na promise. Tinitake natin ang promise na parang hindi natin maintindihan. Na yung mga, I can do all things through Christ. Minsan tingnan natin ang context niya na hindi na lang kay si Christ na sa iyo at kasama ka, you can do whatever you want. Hindi po. Let's be careful. Now, the truth is that God only promises when He takes a vow or makes a covenant or swears an oath. May mga time na makita natin sa Bible na ang Panginoon talaga nag-vow, nag-promise, and He made an oath. One of the promises ng Panginoon na makita natin na hanggang ngayon ay tumatayo at nagre-remind sa atin itong universal flood. Diba? Nire-remind tayo ng Panginoon that when we see the rainbow, it was a promise that is not going to send universal flood again. Yan po ang promise. As I've said, hindi lahat ng salita ng Panginoon sa Bible ay promise. Where God has not made a promise, His words are either understood as threats of curse and offers of blessing. Kung hindi man promise, kung hindi man command, it's either threats of curse or offers of blessing. Alam nyo kung ang Panginoon mag-promise, His words are immutable. God is immutable. Pag sinabi natin immutable, it means unchanging. Unchanging in His purpose, unchanging in His will. Pag ang immutable God nag-promise, His words are also immutable. Meaning, it is unchanging and it will happen. But when we look at God's word, He mostly issues commands and promises. Kanino? He makes promises and commands to those whom He have a relationship with. Tingnan niyo sa Bible. He always make a covenant, a promise or a command. Kanino? Kahit kung sino lang? No. Usually, ang Panginoon gumagawa ng promise at command sa mga tao na may relationship sa Kanya. Especially, ang relationship, in other words, is covenant, ha? Agreement. So, yun sila ang gagawa ng Panginoon ng promise. Okay? Now, how do you know if you have a relationship with Jesus? If you have accepted Him as Lord and Savior, then you are bound in a covenant with Him through that relationship. So, since may relationship tayo sa Panginoon, because of Jesus Christ, mag-promise ang Panginoon sa mga anak niya, then you are bound. Ikaw at ako, sa mga kuman niya, we are bound by that covenant or promise. So, being in a relationship with Jesus, because we accepted Him as Lord and Savior, who belong in these last days are required to fulfill and obey the commands with promise. So, nakita ko ba na ang sinasabi ng author ng Hebrews? This is a message also to those who have a relationship with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. This is a command for each and every child of His. To pay close attention to the things which you have heard before, so that you will not drift away from your faith. Nagbigay ang Panginoon ng commands. Obey the commands of God with promises. Alam nyo, hindi marami ang na-command ng Panginoon na may dalang promise sa Bible. I can only think of two. So baka iba sa inyo meron, then that's good. I found two commands na may dala na promise. Maraming commands sa Old Testament, pero walang dalang promise. Right? Ang command na yan, it's for you and for them to obey. Pero walang promise. Just do it. Merong command pala si Jesus. Dalawa, nakita ko. Na once you do it, kasama ang promise of blessing. The first one, no? What are those? Ephesians 6:1-2. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Kita mo ang command? Honor your father and mother. Because if you are going to honor your parents, this is the command with a promise. Kita mo yung ganda? No? Merong command at merong promise. Alam nyo, may isa pa. Yan nga eh. Ang sabi ng author, it means that the words of the Lord Jesus Christ must be put emphasis on and obey it. May isa pang verse, importante. Familiar? The Great Commission. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, in the Son, in the Holy Spirit. Ito, teaching them to follow, oh, the command, all that I command you. And behold, look at the promise. I am with you always, to the end of the age. When we make disciples, learners of Jesus Christ, He commands it to us, to everyone whom he has a relationship with. If you do it, look at the promise. I am with you always to the end of the age. Jesus has commanded everyone whom he has a relationship with to go and make learners or followers of him. Jesus' command for every believer is called, what do you call this? The Great Commission. The Great Command. This is not the Great Suggestion. This is the Great Commission. You know what? Nowadays, kung tingnan lang natin ang idea na binibigay sa atin ng author ng Hebrews, it is very, very sad. It's very, very sad to hear that there are churches who are not devoting time, who are not devoting effort, they are not devoting attention or focus or listening and doing what Jesus Christ is saying and commanding. Listen to what the author of the book of Hebrews says. In these last days, God is speaking to us through His Son. So listen to His Son. Listen to Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to His commands. Do it and obey it. So you will not drift in your spiritual life. Some of the church today, as we have said, have lots of activities, but some of it are not geared to what Jesus would like to accomplish for His bride or the church. And what is that? Christ likeness. Do you know that this is a means which the Lord Jesus Christ has given us so that we will fulfill the end? What is the end for this? It is being like Christ. Yun nga ang sinasabi ko. It is sad to say that there are churches who are not given, who are not devoting time or effort or attention to what the Lord Jesus Christ is saying. Okay? It is in being a committed learner or follower of Jesus that we will be able to know deeper and deeper, understand deeper the teachings and the instructions of Jesus Christ, and to be taught how to effectively apply God's word in our lives. That's what the author of book of Hebrews is saying. Pay close attention to what you have heard before. This is connected also with what we have last week. Now, once we listen on hear the word of God, we have the responsibility to act on the word of God. Otherwise, we commit sin. We can commit sin if we are not going to act on the words which we have heard that comes from the word of God. Here's the truth. When the body of Christ is not doing the Great Commission, she considers it as the Great Suggestion. Tama. Kasi kung hindi mo ginagawa ang command ni Jesus Christ, then it's just a suggestion. Hindi siya commission or command. As I've said, it's so sad that this is what is happening and what we can see in churches today. Okay? What else? If the body of Christ, the church, is not obeying the most important command of Christ, then the church is disobeying Christ. Tama? What the church must do, kung ma-realize natin ito, is first of all, to repent. Repent. Minsan, parang magtatanong, ha? Ang church? Mag-repent? Parang okay man lang kami sa loob ng church. We sing songs every Sunday. We meditate on the Word of God. We grow deeper in our faith. But yes, those are not bad. Those are good. But the problem there is if we miss the most important command of Christ in these last days, then we are guilty of disobeying Christ. As I've said, the things which He commanded to us are the things which He will require when we face each other. Diba? What if Christ will return and find out that we are not doing what He commands us? Ano ang sasabihin natin sa Kanya? Will somebody face God for you? Will your relatives be there to stand in your stead before God? Wala po. Wala. It is us only. It is me. It is you. Lahat tayo. Isa-isa po tayo. Wala po tayong choice. We are going to face God. So sabi nila, whether you like it or like, you are going to face God. And we are going to answer the things which He commanded us. Now, my next question. What will happen if we are not going to obey what Jesus has commanded? Ano ang mangyari kung hindi natin i-obey? Well, in the passage that we have, it's very clear na ang sabi ng author, we are going to drift away or to let slip or pass by. We are going to drift away. Anong drift away? The truth Jesus Christ revealed and commanded. Alam niyo, may isang famous din to siya na tao na nagsabi, itong sabi niya, truth heard and not acted upon is a dangerous thing. Okay? Truth heard. When we apply it in God's Word, totoo naman yan. Delikado. You can learn or you can know a lot of doctrines in the Bible. Pero if you're not going to apply those doctrines in your life and live it out, baka mag-question ng iba sa karakter mo, sa buhay mo. Right doctrine produces right living. Diba? So, even if we memorize a lot of verses in the Bible and not living it out, and it's gonna be a dangerous thing para sa'yo at sa akin. Huh? Truth heard and not acted upon is a dangerous thing. Now, my next question. Why are we told to avoid drifting? Why did the author of Hebrews told the Christians to avoid drifting in their spiritual life? Bakit? So, ito ba? Kung nagsabi ang author ng Hebrews sa mga Christians to avoid drifting, then let's consider it also that this is His word to us. This is God's word to us. Kung bakit tayo pinapa-avoid sa drifting. Now, why? Ask the question. The reason? Because the author believed to drift. Alam nyo kung anong ibig sabihin ng drift? It's neglect. To drift or neglect in our spiritual life is very, very tragic. Alam nyo, ang spiritual life is not like physical sickness. It's not, hindi siya sinasabi natin na physical ang makita mo na pag may cancer ka, talagang ma-feel mo sa mind mo, sa katawan mo. Spiritual attack is different. We can be well on the outside. We can be okay on the outside. Thinking normal, sleeping normally and everything. But inside, it's different. That's why the author of Hebrews, under the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, wrote this letter warning the believers in that area, the Jewish Christians, to avoid drifting in their spiritual life because it is very, very tragic. Now, neglect in any area of life is tragic. Pag na-neglect mo ang ibang area sa buhay mo, mag-iipekto din ito ng masama. For example, sa ating health. Kung i-neglect mo ang mental, ano mo ba? Yung, ang kulang ng tulog pala, grabe ito makapek sa kidney? Tulog. Sa kidney, ang tulog, grabe pala yan. Ang tulog ay importante so that our immune system will be refreshed. So kung maniglect mo yan, tragic. Physically, lahat ng mga bagay considered tragic. Ask the people na may sakit ngayon and they will affirm na ang maniglect mo, ang physical life mo is very, very tragic. Pinaghirapan mo ng matagal, nag-iipon ka ng matagal, tapos ibili mo lang ng gamot. Meaning, all your life, you have worked and worked and worked, and in the end, you will only spend it on medicines. How tragic. Yeah. So meaning, kung masobraan natin trabaho ngayon, you are just saving money for your sickness later on. That's tragic. In the spiritual aspect of life, hearing the words of the Lord and doing nothing about it is infinitely more tragic. Bakit naging more tragic ang spiritual? Because later on, ang spiritual life natin is a life that we will live eternally. Physical is just short. Eternal is from that wall and that wall, even from Bangkapi up to Central Lataw. Yan po ang diferensya. Ito ang lifetime natin. Ang eternity ay hindi mo ma-measure. The author of the book wrote this letter knowing that if you Christians will neglect the things which the Lord Jesus Christ has revealed, is very, very tragic. Very, very tragic. And I think, I do believe that the author, God Himself, through this author, is reminding us today. The Christians were facing challenges then. Ibang pressure. But we have a different kind of pressure, but we're still living in the same world and we're having the same Lord. So, effective pa rin ang salita ng Panginoon sa kanila at sa atin ngayon. And it serves as a warning. You know what? In Hebrews chapter 3, next chapter, nagsabi ang author, be careful then, dear brothers and sisters. Make sure that your own hearts are not evil and unbelieving. Turning away, that's drifting, from the living God. You must warn each other every day while it is still today, so that none of you will be deceived by sin, drifting, and hardened against God. He wrote it one chapter later. Be careful then. Let us be careful then. And make sure that our hearts are not evil and unbelieving. So, nakita niya that some of them were pulled back in their original religion, which is Judaism, not believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. So they turned away from the living God. So sabi niya, mag-reach of one of you will remind, help each other, spur each other to grow, so that none of you will be deceived by sin at magiging matigas kayo against sa Panginoon. Now, when talking about spiritual drifting, napag-isipan ko, sabi ko, we're talking about a general term ng spiritual drifting. So, I ask myself, really think about this, what are those spiritual evidence of spiritual drifting? I would like to mention some and think about this kung meron kang signs of spiritual drifting in your life. Number one, spiritual drifting can lead to a sense of spiritual separation from God, or it can hinder our growth and intimacy with Him. Alam na natin kung ano ang relationship natin sa Panginoon. Whether close with Him or medyo papalayo na natin. Na tayo. Kung ma-feel mo na parang napapalayo na tayo, then we have the signs of spiritual drifting. What else? Spiritual drifting can undermine our credibility and effectiveness in sharing the gospel. Siyempre, kung malayo ka sa Panginoon, wala ka na rin gana mag-share ng gospel sa iba. No? Hey, wala na. Nawala ng gana na. So, it means nagdi-drift na tayo. Number three, spiritual drifting can have a negative impact on our being an influence sa ating family. Sa iba, sa kapwa nating nagtatrabaho sa isang kumpanya, sa isang school, sa government, or kung saan-saan. Pag nag-spiritually drift na tayo, meron na tayong negative impact sa iba. What else? Spiritual drifting may lead others away from faith kasi nagsiset tayo ng negative example. Maraming tao nung una pa, sinasabi natin, marinig mo lang. As a pastor, I can hear that others are saying na nila lang pupunta sa church. Pastor, kung bakit? Kasi iba mga tao dyan, pareho lang naman kami ginagawa. Pareho lang. So, walang pagkakaiba. So, it doesn't matter if I go to church. Kasi iba dyan, well, we're doing the same thing. What else? Spiritual drifting, ito importante ito, can derail our journey into becoming Christ-like. It can derail to our becoming like the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why the author of the book of Hebrews is saying, do not neglect what you have heard before. Pay much closer attention to what the Lord Jesus Christ is saying or His command. Follow it. Follow it so that you will not drift. Another reminder is this. Neglecting the words of the Lord, ito na siya, nag-start na ang drifting of our spiritual life. Once we neglect the words of the Lord, drifting from our spiritual life starts. You know, alam niyo si Moses, sa Old Testament, even him understood the dangers of drifting spiritually. Si Moses pa, naintindihan niya na. So he reminded the people of God to, sabi niya, only take care and keep your soul diligently, lest you forget the things which you have heard before, which you have seen before. Huh? The idea. And lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life. Look at the word diligently. Make them known to your children and to your children's children. Diligently, diligently, sabi ni Moses. Take care of your spiritual life diligently. Obey God's command and become a committed learner or follower so as to avoid drifting in your spiritual life. That is the only method that Jesus Christ gave us to avoid drifting. So sa ating application, last, ang tanong, in knowing all the things about drifting and the dangers of neglecting the Word of God, how can we avoid drifting in our spiritual life? Paano natin ma-avoid ang spiritual drifting? You know, before that, ang spiritual growth natin is a lifelong journey. Diba yung sinasabi natin? It's a lifelong journey. A process, and occasionally drifting can be part of that journey. May mga times talaga na medyo mas slip, madrift konti. That's part of the journey. That's part of the journey. But the reminder of the author is to take proactive ways. proactive, knowing that there are going to be times that we are going to drift, the author made some proactive ways to remind us to rekindle and deepen our faith in Jesus to avoid that drift. So how can we avoid drifting in our spiritual life? Ito, may mga suggestions tayo dito para ma-avoid natin ang spiritual drifting. At itong mga suggestions na ito, nangangailangan ng intentional effort and commitment. Intentional effort and commitment on your part. The first one is prayer. Prayer. Prayer, really, malaki ang tulong ng prayer. Develop a consistent prayer life. May nagsabi na ang prayer daw is parang 911 call. I don't believe 911 call ang prayer. Ano bang mga tawag sa 911? Hindi ba puro lahat hingi ng tulong? Hingi ng tulong. Now, if you consider prayer as 911, di prayer natin puro hingi. It's not. Prayer is communion with God, talking with God, and lingering in His presence. So, a consistent prayer life, like breakfast, lunch, at dinner. Yan ang mga consistent natin na prayer practices. Di ba? Nanibago ako noong una. Being a son of a pastor at grow up sa church, nanibago ako when I entered Bible school. So, first year kami, kasama namin ibang mga higher year sa kantin. Abo, nag-snack sila mga 9 or 10 o'clock sa break namin. Burger at saka ko, bah, pinipriyan pa. Sobra naman ito. Snacks lang, nagpipray pa. I grew up in a church. Ano, arte naman ito. 3 o'clock, hapon. May mag-snack dyan or may... Man, nagpipray pa. Nagpapakita ba ito na malapit sa malapit sa Diyos? Yung mga ganon. Di ba sa atin, ano lang yan? Kain? Oh? Breakfast? Lunch? Eh kung walang lunch, walang prayer. So, sobra na ito ah. Tapos mag-prayer meeting pa. May evening gathering pa ng mga lalaki. Ma-prayer pa agad. Later on, you really have to appreciate na hindi ka makakain, even ng sabaw, or whatever din na hindi ka makapag-pray. Now, to develop a consistent prayer life, intentional din ito, at saka yung to commit ourselves. Sana hindi lang tayo maghingi sa mag-pray at nasa Panginoon na may hingiin tayo. No? At hindi lang tayo mag-pray kung naalang-alanganin na tayo sa buhay. We should also spend time just praising and praising and praising and praising God for what He did. Yeah. Hindi natin alam kung minsan that He's working in our lives, in our body, physical life, na ang Panginoon din is working in us, not for us to have sickness. No. Ginagawa niya ang bagay dapat niya gawin sa loob ng katawan natin to prevent us. And the things ba na while traveling, yung sinasabi nila na traveling mercies ng Panginoon, hindi lang natin alam na ang Panginoon just really, really save us from any accidents or kung saan tayo pumupunta. It's good thing hindi naman tayo niya sinabi na punta kayo dun sa may Sayang Paragon during shooting. Shooting days. So, anong mga bagay ba? Maliit lang yan, pero papasalamatan natin ang Panginoon because hindi tayo conscious but He is doing His part. And nagde-deserve siya talaga ng pasalamat lang. Hindi lang hingi. Okay. What else? Bible study. Commit to a regular Bible study group. You know, ang nakita ko ba, to study alone is okay. Pero to study alone, may mga times na darating na hindi ka magiging constant. Be with someone. Be with someone. Be accountable to someone sa pag... You group together and decide a date para mag-discipline. Yan ang nakita ko. Now, of course, sa akin, I would like to study the Bible and meditate on it. And more, siyempre kung mag-prepare ka ng sermon sa aming mga pastor. But when it comes to learning and growing, mas maganda kung nandun kayo sa group. Commit to a regular Bible study group. Malaking tulong ito. Next, be mentored. Hindi ito sinasabi sa atin eh. Itong laging be mentored. Kasi, ha? Magpa-mentor ako. Bakit? Kailangan ko bang mentoring? Okay naman ako. Okay. But you know what? Being mentored means have someone to journey in faith with to provide support and guidance. May mga bagay na ang mentor na makita para sa atin that to really help us in our faith journey. May mga bagay ba na hindi natin makita? May mga bagay na gusto natin i-decide na hindi tayo they can help. They can help. They can guide us. They can say things na i-avoid natin. At they can say things na ipatuloy natin. Be mentored. And then, what else? Set spiritual goals. Ano ba ang spiritual goal natin sa taong ito? To end this 2023 in December, ano bang gusto natin ma-accomplish sa spiritual life natin? Have clear and spiritual objectives to help you stay focused and committed. Once may goal na tayo, meron tayong i-pursue. Kung walang goal, eh di wala. So, mas maganda kung mag-set tayo ng spiritual goals natin. And then, periodically evaluate. Periodically evaluate. I know na iba sa atin pumupunta sa doctor to have a general check-up. That is to evaluate our physical life. May nagsasabi nga sa akin, Pastor, bakit hindi ka magpa-general check-up? Ang sagot ko, bakit? Bakit ako general check-up? Now, sinasabi ko lang yan kasi I feel okay. But who knows? Di ba? Ganun din lahat sa atin. Kasi if we are going to have a general check-up, then malalaman natin kung ano ang mga bagay na may meaning, baka okay lang tayo ngayon. Pero sa kabila, mataas na pala ang dugo, sugar, mix mo yan, nandiyan sa atin yan, dugo, sugar, ano pa, oil, ano pang mga bagay na mataas sa atin, pressure, oh, those are the things. Now, periodically evaluate. If we evaluate our physical life, then it's also good to evaluate our spiritual life. Evaluate your spiritual progress and identify drifting areas and take corrective actions as needed. Ano bang mga bagay na nagko-contribute sa iyo or nagko-contribute sa drifting mo? Ano bang mga bagay na nag-ahadlang sa iyo in your spiritual life? In your spiritual journey? Is work ang nag-ahadlang na hindi ka makagrow sa Panginoon? Family ba? Time with the family? Friends? Financial? Ano bang mga bagay? Identify it. Pray to the Lord to give you wisdom so that you can identify those things that hinders your spiritual walk sa Panginoon. So, mas maganda kung meron tayong evaluation sa ating spiritual life. Now, sinasabi ko kanina, itong mga suggestions na ito, nagangailangan ito ng intentional effort and commitment. Here's a reminder for us. Consistency and intentionality in our spirituality through the help of the Holy Spirit can help us avoid spiritual drifting in our lives. Ang prayer ko sana na this will be our prayer starting today. To be enabled by the Holy Spirit to have consistency and intentionality in our pursuit to be Christ-like. To pursue Christ alone in our own effort is hard and difficult. But through the enablement of the Holy Spirit, we will be amazed that pwede pala, little by little, as we journey every day. Now, I would like to give you this last verse. Ang sabi ni Apostle Paul sa mga taga-Galatians is this, Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay in death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. So anong sabi niya? He's also saying this to us. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. So what is that good thing that we do? Let us pursue Christ and obey the commands of Christ. Put emphasis on it. Put emphasis on it. So that we will avoid spiritual drifting. And then, sabi niya, at just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. Sana ma-remember natin ito. Ang letter ng author to the Christians is also a reminder for us not to set aside the things that the Lord Jesus Christ is saying. So follow it. Do it before He comes again. So may God, the Holy Spirit, will give us the enablement of a life that is steadfast in our faith to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Shall we pray? Lord, gracious God, we thank you for a telling reminder for us. The world where we live in keeps on bombarding us with influence and the things around us so that we will drift in our faith. We will be stagnant in our faith so that your purpose for us to be like your Son, Jesus Christ, will not happen. Lord, today you reminded us and encouraged us to just continue doing what we do, and that is to cling and abide Lord Jesus Christ and to grow deeper in our faith so that we will avoid drifting in our spiritual life. Thank you for your word, and thank you for the promise of the Holy Spirit that He is there, He is going to enable us, He is going to help us as we journey daily to become like your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, bless this church, the body of Christ, and every believer, and even those who have heard your word today, that you will enable them in their daily spiritual walk. Rebuke Satan as he is going to attack all your children to drift in their faith, to set aside the very important commands that you gave us. Lord, help us and enable us every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.